Hey guys, welcome back. So now getting back into Justice League, within Year of the Villain to where Perpetua, whew, goodness, who mind you at this point still isn't at full power, but she is getting there rather quickly. And with doing so at this point, she is the front runner for the Year of the Villain award, if there is one. Because these villains been working hard, so let's get into it. But first, if you're new to the channel, be sure to subscribe to catch the spills every week. And don't forget to hit that bell up top so we can squat up in the comments for the first hour. Alright, so in our last talk about Justice League, we had gotten into the whole battle at the edge of the universe within the Promethean galaxy, to where at this point the heroes had made their attempt to split up into different teams, sending William Payton Starman here with Kendra and Shane, as well as with the Brothers 3, while two other groups went into the past and the future in order to retrieve the other pieces of the totality, with the plans of bringing them together and imprisoning her here like she had been many years ago. But of course this didn't work out, with Kendra running out of power at the wrong time. But the thing that had truly tipped the scale was everyone who had sided with Doom, much thanks to the recruitment of Lex Luthor. Because with her gaining an exponential amount of followers and also taking back her son, the Anti-Monitor, this then strengthened her signal not only to be shown throughout the universe, but throughout the multiverse. And it's like, if only Instagram was here to take away her likes, like the heroes would have had a chance. But nope, that ain't the case, they on their own. But one of the things with Perpetua's sign going up for everybody to see, and I mean everywhere throughout the multiverse, this gives us like a bit of a mile marker between the tie-ins as far as what's happening in relation to the main event. And even with doing so, some are a little bit easier to pinpoint than others, like with Rick Grayson and his story being completely separate from everything happening in Justice League. But then you also have other cases like the Infected, which is mainly your Batman Superman situation, which is slightly expanded with the addition of the Secret Six. But this is like one of the perfect examples of a couple things you got to keep in mind when you have multiple events simultaneously running, and when doing so we're not really given the specific time that events happen in relation to one another, mainly for the sake of not giving spoilers and kind of pushing you to read the other tie-ins to pick up other hints and pieces to the main scope of what's happening. And just to stay on the topic of the Infected with Batman and Superman versus Justice League and the Year of the Villain, just for a little bit. Like, for one, Batman Superman is a bit of an isolated case, mainly because very early on in the series, Batman and Superman have kept the whole infection investigation to themselves, which is something of course the writers do so it doesn't get too messy, because when you have multiple writers and multiple series, people need a little bit of liberty, and so everybody's hands aren't tied up into one specific spot. But eventually we do get more information as far as what happens when, closer towards the conclusion of a series, and if not at the conclusion of the series, then very early in the next one, much like with the Batman Who Laughs miniseries, which ran directly into Batman Superman. And getting back into Justice League, we get a bit more of that here as well, which I'll get into a little bit more in just a few minutes, when we get one of those when examples in the form of Mary when she was searching for her brother Billy, which we had seen in King Shazam. But so now at this point, with Perpetua's sign in the sky for the multiverse to see, this is one of those things that polarized the general public, with most of them thinking back to Lex Luthor's announcement back when he faked his death, and they look back on it like, man, Luthor was right. The universe is heading towards Doom. I knew I should have became a villain and took that check. And they like, is it too late? Can Luthor cash at me? But this has also like boosted the hatred for the Justice League, with Luthor mentioning that they had failed time and time again, and with doing that, really trying to tell the world that the Justice League are the true enemy. And now with Perpetua's sign up, people are taking that as confirmation, because for many, seeing is believing. But this also yet again plays into the favor with people siding with Doom, much like that old song, In the Hearts of Men. Some people are just like, whichever side's winning, that's my side. And this yet again plays into Perpetua's favor. And so now in the case of the Justice League, who's really scratching their heads at this point, because with your past and future team who had made their way back to the present and here at the Hall of Justice, it's like they arrived into the final seconds of their own defeat, which was given with an explanation point with the death of William Payton, the Starman who was in the Promethean galaxy who was killed by Perpetua. And though the rest of the heroes weren't actually there to witness it taking place, but they know that he's gone with the signal going out and the other Starman not being able to detect him, with William Payton's signal going dark so abruptly. But even with everybody else here on Earth, you still have Kendra and Shane, who were last with Starman in the Promethean galaxy, who are still out there in need of a way back. And as for the heroes who still aren't sure how they're gonna fix this, like, they've gone through a number of ideas. And even one of them was using Jarro to seize the minds of different planets and pull them away from siding with Doom. But at this point, that's not really an option, because little Jarro still has much growing to do and he's not at that power level just yet. Even though not too long ago he had a similar idea and he was going to use this same tactic on the Legion of Doom. But really what this has done is caused the Justice League to understand that what they should have been doing is working together with everyone and using their allies to prevent people from siding with Doom and fighting with the universe instead of fighting for it. Which now is like the obvious plan. plan, but it's like hindsight is 2020. And now with all the heroes having to deal with where everything's at and just really take it from here, we get a glimpse of others who are seeing the sign, like Mary, who had seen it on her way to go find Billy, which as I mentioned earlier is like one of those hints towards when this is happening in relation to everything else that's going on, like Justice League Dark, Leviathan, Justice League Odyssey, and much more. But with Perpetua signs showing everywhere in the multiverse, and that's another thing, because if you guys want to go deeper into some of the other locations or some of the other tie-ins, just let me know down in the comments so we can do that. But one of the things that I thought was pretty interesting, out of all the people who had taken notice, like for me it had to be Barbatos, who has been on lockdown for the longest, since Dark Knight's Metal, and like this whole time with the Batman Who Laughs who's just been wilding out throughout the full duration of Year of the Villain, and when doing so using a lot of what Barbatos had shown him after the Batman Who Laughs had conquered his own Earth and Barbatos introduced him into the fuller scope of the multiverse. But so now from here we jump over to Earth 19, which if anyone's not familiar with, it's a very late 1800s, early 1900s type of landscape, and it even remains so in the 21st century. But in their case with Perpetua arriving here, in addition to her sign being in the sky, she's arrived here to personally announce mainly her disappointment with this Earth and this universe being one of the few to where a mass majority of it have not sided with Doom. And when she arrives here, Earth 19 Batman and Inspector Gordon, they try to reach out to the other heroes throughout the multiverse, but even with doing so, they're not able to contact anyone. And this is really a bad situation for them, because they don't even have like the technology to truly combat a threat like this, let alone any pieces of the totality to have a significant chance. But with Perpetua arriving here and expressing her disgust in this universe that clings to justice, she comes through and she completely eradicates Earth 19. And with doing this, officially from this point forward, there is no Earth 19. Like, she annihilated it. It's gone. And once again, keep in mind, though Perpetua has gained more power, she's still not at full power. But even in the meantime, she's still building her army, to which she has chosen Lex Luthor to lead. And while she's coming into full power, like during that time, she's pretty much going to send Lex on this mission to purge the multiverse from all the worlds who have sided with justice, which will of course increase the Doom percentage and tilt even more the power into her favor. But during this time, like I mentioned before, you still have Shane and Kendra, who are still adrift within the Promethean galaxy. And as far as Kendra, who's injured from her battle with Lex, she's really just overall in a bad place right now, because one, she's physically hurt and her and Shane are adrift in space, but also she feels a lot of the blame for that final battle not working out, mainly because she didn't reserve her power during that fight with Lex. Because at the time, the plan was for her and Starman to alternate with feeding power to the Brothers Three, but she was determined at killing Lex and she burned out too early. And it's because of this she's really blaming herself for all the failure. But even with them out here, they're eventually able to make communication back with the Hall of Justice. And at this point in time, with the heroes who have arrived back from the past and the future, they really don't know what has happened out there at the Promethean galaxy. Not exactly. All they really know is that they didn't win. But as soon as they gain communication, Batman tells Shane that they need to get him and Kendra back to Earth as soon as possible. And to do so, Batman's going to do most of the work remotely, so that all that Shane has to do is press a button. Because with Perpetua gaining all this power, it isn't but a matter of time before they get spotted. And like immediately after he says that, Lex Luthor spots them, and really doing so with the same Martian telepathy methods which Shane had used on him when Shane had tried earlier to reach out to John Johns within him. But with him reaching out and pinpointing exactly where they're at, just before they can jump through the bleed to get back home quickly, their ship is attacked and knocked off course. And it's like, with this being done, there's no telling where they're gonna end up landing. And even depending on where they do land, there's no telling how much time exactly they'll have or how long they'll last till someone can find them, or at least they can manage a way for them to get back, which is pretty crazy. But essentially, the death of the Earth 19 universe, this essentially is just the first step of Perpetua's multiversal massacre. And at this rate of her power increasing, like, any universe could be next. And it's pretty obvious that places like Earth 0 or Earth 3, that worlds like those are pretty much safe because they doomed out. And when I say safe, I mean like from total destruction. She's still coming for everybody. But man, Earth 19 is gone. Like, it's gone. It's gone. Like, it's still hard to kind of process this whole thing. But even with doing all this, Perpetua then tells Lex that now this is the time for her to give him the tools that he needs, which of course are the seven dark forces of the multiverse, which Lex also does express that this is the main part that he's been waiting for. But do keep in mind, and I'm gonna keep reminding you guys like as often as I can remember, because when the Batman Who Laughs gave Lex like the plans and the steps and everything he needed to do to gain this power that he wanted, the Batman Who Laughs had pretty much told Lex Lex that this is where you're gonna mess up. Because at the end of the day, Lex Luthor has to be at the center of everything. And as soon as he steps into that, that's where Lex is gonna fail. But that'll do it for this one, guys. Like, I'm gonna go ahead and make my prediction. Like, I believe that the Batman Who Laughs is going to save the multiverse. And like, not just to do it like out of the kindness of his heart, like why would he do that, but rather I believe that the Batman Who Laughs is gonna do this to fulfill the prediction of the Joker, who said that the Batman Who Laughs is gonna destroy Lex Luthor in an epic way. Because much like in Batman Superman, the Batman Who Laughs had said that Batman always wins, but also with Shane saying things like somebody save us please Batman, I also kind of feel like he's gonna use Shane's sixth dimensional help in order to make this as worse as possible for Lex Luthor. But either way, let me know your thoughts down in the comments below, and we'll do it again in the next one. All right, later.